So now that you've simulated the leaky-integrate-fire model, we will consider the input-output function of that same model. Any element of an electrical circuit is understood in terms of its input-output function. For instance, a transistor will be understood in terms of the current flowing through as a function of the potential between the gates. Now, if a neuron is a core computational unit, similar to the transistor, what is its input-output function? Well, this is a fairly complicated question because we don't really know what's the input feature that is to be considered, and we don't really know what's the output feature that's to be communicated. Well, today I will simplify that problem a little bit, and from the myriads of synapses impinging on the cell and giving rise to currents that are then triggering processes in the dendrites, I will only consider the currents that are flowing from the dendrites and the synapses that are in the cell body that are the ones that are most immediately going to give rise to an action potential. So I'm going to consider features of this input current. Generally, its amplitude, how much current is flowing through. Now, the output can be many possible features of the output spike trains, as you will see. So the simplest scenario is a condition where you have constant input, a constant current I that is stimulating the neuron. So if we consider a leaky integrate-fire model where this current is stimulating changes in the membrane potential until it reaches the threshold where the membrane potential is reset, then the responses will look a little bit like this. And you see that after an absolute refractory period, the membrane potential follows a relaxation to a steady state, and it is first reaching the threshold, emits an action potential, resets. And the whole process starts again exactly the same way. Now, a natural feature to look at is the interspike interval, the amount of time between two spikes. So this is a firing, this taken as an inverse is the firing frequency. And note that if I were to calculate the number of spikes within a fairly large time window and divide that number of spikes by the length of that window, I would also get a firing frequency, which would be exactly equivalent to the inverse of the interspike interval. So this firing frequency will depend on the current, the magnitude of the current being injected. Firing will start at some point where current is strong enough to elicit an action potential. And then it follows this logarithmic curve, which will go to an asymptote of 1 over the absolute refractory period. The curve can be found analytically fairly easily from the equations of the leaky integrate-fire model. And you see that there's a logarithm, and it depends on the parameters of the model, in particular, the current and the distance to the threshold. Now, what happens if there is noise on top of this? Imagine that it's not just a mean input, but there are fluctuations that might have to do with the fact that there's not always exactly the same number of inputs at any moment of time stimulating that neuron. So we add noise to the leaky integrate-fire model, and the output will look fairly similar, but more noisy. Now, you can't calculate the interspike interval at one point and call it the frequency. You need to average over multiple spikes. So you can, for instance, take the inverse of the average interspike interval. And if you plot this, you see that whereas in the absence of noise, we had a sharp transition to starting a response and a very strong gain at the onset of the input-output function. In the presence of noise, the input-output function is much more linear. So that is to say that the noise is linearizing the input-output function. Another interesting aspect is that in average currents that were previously not eliciting any response, that is, that are in a mean amplitude below the threshold, are able to elicit a small response, a small firing rate. This is because these spikes are being driven by fluctuations, random fluctuations that happen to be strong enough to elicit a response. And since these are fairly infrequent, you see a small firing rate. Now, the analytical equation that describes this curve is also known. It's called the Seegert equation. It is made of error function, but it's a fairly complicated equation, so I don't show it here. So I've shown you that a constant current combined with a background noise can be understood in terms of the average interspike interval in response to that input. But that's not the whole story. The interspike interval can be more or less variable. For instance, here, in two different simulations of the integrated fire model with noise, we see that there's a case where if I make the histogram of the different interspike intervals, the interspike intervals are all narrowly centered around their mean. That is, they're not very variable. They're always pretty much the same interspike interval. And in another case, you might have a much more variable interspike interval. And this can happen roughly at the same mean. So it's possible that this irregularity is used for coding. So what we'll do is we'll compute the CV, which is just a natural statistic to take in that case. The CV is just the standard deviation of the interspike interval, so the width of this curve, over the mean, so the mean interspike interval. Now, in the same situation that I've illustrated previously, where the response will grow as a function of the average injected current, and where we can delineate the area where you were below threshold in the absence of noise, you see that the CV will decrease with the average injected current, and that below that threshold, the CV is markedly higher. This has driven people to talk about two regimes. We have the fluctuation-driven regime, where the neuron will not be able to fire if it were not of those fluctuations. And it is associated with high CV and high irregularity. And then there's the mean-driven regime, where the neuron is mostly driven by the mean, and the neuron is firing regularly at an interspike interval with very narrow distribution. So to conclude, the firing rate response of a leaky-integrate-fire model is a nonlinear function of the current that is arriving to the neuronal cell body. Also, noise can linearize, that is, make more linear this input-output function, and the variability of the responses doesn't depend only on the variability of the inputs, but depends on both the mean and the variance of the input. So in the next exercise, you'll be exploring this. You'll be exploring how a leaky integrate-fire neuron model driven by noisy input gives rise to various types of output.